Okay, so welcome to the Assessing Agricultural Technologies for Their Impacts on Gender Roles and Nutrition webinar. This will be a webinar by the Integrating Gender and Nutrition within Agricultural Extension Services Project, which is funded by the United States Agency for International Development and the U.S. Government Feed the Future Initiative. So INGENAES, I'm going to go over a couple housekeeping things first. I'm glad this slide reminded me. Make sure your line is muted. I don't believe you can become unmuted unless I change a setting, so you should be fine. The presentation will last about 40 minutes, and then we'll go through a question and answer session with the hosts. If you have any questions for the presenters, please type them into the chat box on the left. And finally, if you are experiencing technical difficulties, please send a private message to INGENAES, or you can try emailing me, Katie Hines, and I will put my email in the chat box shortly. So what does INGENAES stand for? It's kind of a long acronym. It's the Integrating Gender and Nutrition within Agricultural Extension Services project, and that is designed to assist partners in Feed the Future countries to build more robust, gender-sensitive, and nutrition-sensitive institutions, projects, and programs capable of assessing and responding to the needs of both men and women farmers through extension and advisory services. We collaborate with extension educators, with agricultural staff. I'm getting a few calls right now from people trying to get into the webinar. So if you hear a ringing, that's what that is. So we collaborate with agricultural extension, gender, and nutrition experts worldwide, supporting extension providers in focus countries to disseminate gender appropriate and nutrition enhancing technologies and access to inputs to improve women's agricultural productivity and enhance household nutrition, to identify, test efficacy, and scale proven mechanisms for delivering improved EAS to women farmers and men farmers. And we want to help apply effective nutrition sensitive extension approaches and tools for engaging both men and women. So this webinar will be focused largely on action area 3 you see here to disseminate technologies that enhance women's productivity and improve nutritional outcomes. I'm going to introduce the presenters now. Cristina Manfre is a gender and development specialist with 10 years of experience improving development organizations' attention to gender issues in economic growth, agriculture, and trade programming. She is a senior associate at Cultural Practice LLC, where she provides support on gender integration to a range of institutions, including the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the Center for International Forestry Research, Lutheran World Relief, and USAID for Feed the Future initiatives. She brings over a decade of experience and knowledge in gender issues as they relate to agriculture and a subset of technical areas, including economic growth, agriculture and food security, value chain development, capacity building, and extension and advisory services. Ms. Manfre is a co-author on several well-regarded and frequently consulted USAID publications on integrating gender into extension advisory services and value chains. Now, Caitlin Nordehn is a development practitioner providing technical and administrative support on agriculture, health, and gender-focused activities. She has also supported knowledge management activities and conducted research on internationally focused organization development activities. Along with Cristina Manfre, Caitlin has experience analyzing the role of information and communication technologies in delivering agricultural information to men and women farmers in Kenya in particular. So I'll hand this off now to Cristina and Caitlin. And if you have any questions for them, please write in the chat box and we'll get that to them.
Great. Thanks, Katie. Good afternoon, good morning, and good evening. This is Cristina Manfre speaking. I assume everybody can hear us, and we'll just forge ahead. Today, we're going to talk about the INGENAES Gender and Nutrition Technology Assessment process. We'll start with a review of a couple concepts. We'll give a background for how the Gender and Nutrition Technology Assessment process came about. Then we'll introduce elements of that process and share our findings from a pilot activity that occurred over the last year between July 2015 and wrapping up earlier this summer, 2016. That'll take about 40 minutes, as Katie said earlier, and then we'll move to a Q&A. And please, if you could, as we're talking, if you want to go ahead and start entering your questions into the chat box, Katie and the one of us who's not in the process of presenting will start to field some of those, and we'll get to those at the end. So, what is the Gender and Technology Assessment? This is an analytical process that we developed under INGENAES to understand the potential gender-related and nutritional impacts of specific agricultural technologies on men and women. For us, when we talk about agricultural technologies, we use Catherine Ragasa's definition from a 2012 paper, in which she defines technologies as practices or techniques, tools or equipment, know-how, and skills that are used to enhance productivity, reduce production and processing costs, and save on scarce resources. So included in those, in that definition, we include things like improved varieties, seed varieties, which can increase productivity or be resistant to different stressors like drought. We would include physical technologies like the picture there of a mill or irrigation pumps, tillers, and we include technology, in the definition, we also include practices as part of technologies. And so we are looking at conservation ag, we would include some of those practices in this assessment process. We don't exclude information and communication technologies. I received that question a number of times. We would consider ICTs also under this assessment as part of a technology and an important agricultural technology for the role that they play in disseminating information about different technologies and practices. The assessment came about in part because INGENAES is an extension project, and we're looking at the important role that extension officers play in disseminating and promoting different types of agricultural technologies. So as Katie mentioned before, our action area number three is to disseminate technologies that enhance women's productivity and improve nutritional outcomes. And when we began to think about what this meant, we were really looking, we considered sort of the agricultural research agenda and thinking about what the challenges were for identifying, designing, and then disseminating technologies that could really have an impact on women's roles or reduce the gender inequalities and the gender gaps that have been vastly cited or well recognized by in the Food and Agriculture State of paper from 2011. In looking at this space where agricultural technologies are being designed and disseminated, I think we were dissatisfied by two things. First, by the overemphasis on the technological solution to our agricultural challenges, that much of the discussion revolves around the importance of a new seed or a new piece of machinery or the practice. And this overemphasis on the technological fix tends to shadow what we feel are very important things that need to be understood about men and women and their needs and preferences and interests. The second piece that we're somewhat dissatisfied from sitting here in the United States is that when you look at the ways in which products are marketed to women, and I am being a little tongue-in-cheek here, that you see that there is this tendency when you want to reach women to shrink it and pink it, which means that you're making it cute and you're making it, you know, as the slide shows, you're turning it into something that's pink. They often, when you do this, unfortunately in the United States, it also comes with a price premium. Now, while some women may like the availability of a pink tractor or a pink mill, We would argue that that's probably not the first strategy or the best strategy to reaching women farmers. Furthermore, this process or this shrink it and pink it phenomena, we would argue, is based really on assumptions and stereotypes about women and girls. So we would recommend an analytical process that looks beyond not just the technology itself, you know, moving beyond the technology as the silver bullet, and also moves beyond stereotypes about women and girls and examines gender roles a little bit more carefully. So the assessment process really focuses on this interplay between the social context and specifically the gender dynamics in specific contexts and how technology is designed and delivered. On the one hand, you have the top arrow. You have this, what do we, this, an examination of the context. What is it that we know about what men and women do in a particular area? And how does that influence the choices that we make about the different technologies that receive attention or the different practices that undergo review for, say, a technological upgrade? On the reverse side, the bottom arrow, which is technologies to gender roles, is what we're interested in understanding is the opportunity that agricultural technologies present for influencing and shaping gender roles in ways that can support gender equality and women's empowerment. So let me explain a little bit further. If we go back to that top arrow of looking at gender roles and how they link to technology, what we know is that in the agriculture sector, women and men are responsible for different tasks along the agricultural value chain. That women may be involved in weeding or post-harvest handling, and men may be more involved in some places in land preparation. This can impact their preferences, their needs, and their interests in different ways. As the example on the slide presents, the research around participatory varietal selection with new seed varieties often reveals that women tend to rank characteristics associated with their household responsibilities. So when they're reviewing new seeds or participating in trials, they'll rank things like cooking time or taste or texture much higher than men will. They also tend to rank productivity as a highly desirable trait as well. So it's important to understand that they recognize things that men also recognize as important in terms of new varieties, but then they have a slightly different read on what a new maize variety or new rice variety can do. And it links to what their roles are in their day-to-day life. Women also spend a disproportionate amount of time on labor-intensive activities. Collecting water is the one that's often most cited. Here we're still talking about that top arrow from the previous slide, where if we know more about what it is that men and women do, we have the opportunity to identify places in the value chain or in people's daily lives that could improve with a technological solution. So the image on the slide that you're seeing now, I chuckled when I found it the other day among our INGENAES photos, because here we see three women carrying an incredible load of on their backs. And if you can't, hopefully you can see there's a nice shiny new Jeep in the back, which I would like to think that they might really welcome the opportunity to take that load off their back and use some other technology to transport what they're carrying. So technology presents this opportunity to alleviate and improve men and women's well-being, but we have to understand what it is that men and women do and where we can make savings, whether it's time or energy expenditure in their daily lives. Finally, when we come and look at the bottom arrow, or when we consider the bottom arrow, which is the influence technology can have on shaping men and women's roles, we consider the way in which technologies in their first and most direct impact, how it changes the quantity and quality of agricultural products. So technologies are often about increasing productivity or reducing or improving the use of scarce resources. Those may be the first and immediate direct impacts of agricultural technologies or purposes of agricultural technologies. But what they also tend to do is have a knockoff effect on income and nutrition. So if the technology, for example, a new seed, is in a crop that is dominated by men or that men market, they are likely to be the ones who will benefit from an improved higher yields and more of that particular product, or an improvement in the quality, which can also change the value of that product. So we would argue that you want to think about not just the immediate technology, but how that technology is used throughout the value chain. And it's not just an income effect, but you can see there may be nutritional value to it as well. As you increase the availability of food, can you also make improvements in terms of quality and safety? And even just the availability of diverse foods may change what households have available to distribute among different members in that particular household. So the gender and technology assessment is used to kind of tease out and explore that interplay between what we know about gender, the gender context or gender dynamics in particular context, and what the research agenda is around technology and how technologies are designed, used, and disseminated. It uses a gender analysis to explore these issues, and we focus on three issues that Kate will now speak about in a moment: food availability, quality, and safety, time and labor, income and assets. The assessment is used to identify gender-based constraints and how these shape the adoption process and dissemination efforts. And as an outcome or as an output of the assessment process, we aim to identify specific actions that can improve the design, use, or dissemination of particular technologies in ways that speak back to our original action area of INGENAES, which is to make available technologies that can enhance women's productivity and improve nutritional outcomes. So I'll hand over now to Kate. All
right. Okay, so I'm going to walk you through the process of the technology assessment. The technology assessment examines the technology that's being used in a particular context. There are five steps to this process. First, you want to understand the technology. How does it work? Secondly, we want to learn about how it was developed. Who designed the technology? How was it designed? Were men or women farmers involved in that design process? We also want to know a little bit more about where it was being disseminated and what kinds of training was involved and who participated in that. After steps one and two, you should have a better understanding of what the technology is intended to do, who it's designed for, and who is using it. In step three, we're beginning to do our gender analysis. We're interested in learning about the differences in men's and women's experiences using the technology and the impacts that it's had on their lives. We do this by interviewing men and women who are using the technology, as well as those who are not. We also talk to the people who are disseminating the technology and those training the farmers to use it, such as extension agents or people who are involved with a particular project. Once you've collected that data through interviews, we analyze it to understand the differences in men's and women's experiences using the technology. We're interested in knowing things like, did men and women have equal access to the technology? How were men and women affected by the new technology? Were there differences? What kinds of constraints were they facing? In step four, we want to connect that back to the design of the technology and the dissemination efforts. We want to understand in what ways the design of the technology or the ways it was disseminated may have contributed to those differences. And then, using that information, we can identify actions to ensure that both women and men will benefit from the technology. We may also want to identify new ways to monitor those changes. These actions will take into account design features and dissemination efforts. So next I'm going to walk you through our analytical framework that we've used to do the gender analysis, which primarily takes place in steps three, four, and five. In this assessment, we're particularly interested in three areas that Cristina mentioned before. Those include food availability, quality and safety, time and labor, and income and assets. You see in this graphic, we've put technology at the center because we're interested in understanding what the effects of the technology are on men and women related to these three different areas. These changes may be positive or negative for different groups of people. First, we want to better understand what the technology has changed in terms of food availability, quality, and safety for the household, and what kinds of implications it has for men and women within the household. Next, we assess the effects of a technology on men's and women's time and labor. As Cristina mentioned, many technologies are going to create some kind of changes in time spent on particular tasks, and that is related to the roles that men and women play. Lastly, the assessment can help us understand changes in men's and women's access to income and assets. After using the technology, we want to understand how changes in income and assets are affecting different people within the household. Next, I'm going to walk you through each of these areas in a little bit more depth, highlighting some of the key questions the technology assessment can help you answer about the impacts of the technology around these three areas. I will also highlight some of the findings from the INGENAES technology assessments, which were piloted in 2015. Our first area of inquiry is food availability, quality, and safety. As Cristina mentioned earlier, technology has the potential to change food availability. It can increase production. A new technology like a high-yielding variety of wheat could increase yields. This will mean an increase in the potential food available for consumption. Storage technologies can prolong the availability of food for consumption. We want to consider who may have control over the technology and what the implications are for access to that food within the household. For example, on the technology assessment of the Purdue Improved Crop Storage Bags carried out in Zambia, men and women interviewed reported that the use of the bags reduced post-harvest losses of maize and cowpea. The PIX bags are designed to prevent post-harvest loss caused by pests called weevils. We, at this point, have general information about these changes, but the assessment does not deal well with who has benefited as a result of these changes within the household or community. So for each of the technology assessments, this is something that we're looking to better understand. In this area of inquiry, we're also interested in understanding differences in men's and women's preferences for the quality of food, which Cristina had mentioned earlier. Because women, men and women play different roles. For example, women who are responsible for cooking may prefer a variety of rice because of its qualities. Lastly, technology can also make food safer. For example, the technology AflaSafe, a biocontrol method for management of aflatoxins, which is a fungus affecting crops, which can have significant health impacts. This technology AflaSafe can improve the safety of food. In an assessment of AflaSafe in Zambia, women reported the quality of diets had improved because they believed they were consuming fewer aflatoxins. However, the assessment found that more research is needed to confirm this. Our next area of inquiry is time and labor. Often we hear that certain technologies can save time or improve labor conditions. In the course of a day, men and women have a lot to do. Some tasks that men and women do might be similar and others different. In many cultural contexts, women take on the bulk of the household work in addition to working on the farm. When a new technology is introduced, it could reduce or lengthen the amount of time it takes to perform a task. This could, in some way, free up time for other activities. We want to consider whose time, men's or women's, is being shifted and what the implications are for them. One of the technology assessments found that men and women in Bangladesh using what is called a fertilizer deep placement techniques in rice production, instead of using broadcasting the fertilizer, may save labor in weeding, but may increase labor in transplanting the seeds, fertilizer application, and harvesting. In this technology assessment, we found that more research is needed to understand the implications of these trade-offs. A technology can also create employment opportunities or can eliminate them. We want to know if men's employment is changing, if women's employment is changing as a result of the technology. and different groups of men and different groups of women's employment is changing. Many of the tasks for both men and women can also cause physical strain on the body and fatigue. Technologies can be introduced that reduce drudgery. For example, an assessment of the treadle pump in Zambia, men and women reported previous methods of collecting water for irrigation. They said it took a lot of time and it was exhausting. The treadle pump, they said, reduced the amount of time overall needed to irrigate, and it reduced drudgery. We also want to know, does the technology shift labor between men and women? For example, a technology can move manual labor done by women to a machine controlled by men. Our last area of inquiry is income and assets. It asks you to consider the impacts of a technology has on men's and women's access and control of income and assets. Why? This influences their ability to both use and purchase the technologies and benefit from them. New technologies are designed to increase production often, which can lead to higher yields and more surplus to sell. While income may be higher if farmers are selling more of a particular crop, we want to understand the extent to which women or men control that income. An assessment of the digital fat tester, which provides information about milk fat content, was introduced in Bangladesh through CARE's Strengthening the Dairy Value Chain project. Women learned to produce higher quality milk through the project. The project also encouraged women to become registered producers, so when they brought their milk to local collection centers, they would receive that income directly. So here's an example of women driving direct access to control of that income, which they may benefit from. Technologies can also shift who is doing what on the farm. For example, landless women who earn income through wage labor for activities like weeding may be displaced when new conservation agriculture practices are adopted, which reduces the need for weeding. Alternatively, technologies could also create new employment opportunities. In a technology assessment of women involved in homestead pond project in Bangladesh, which aimed to improve both household nutrition and generate income opportunities for women, the analysis showed that more could be done to encourage women to sell fish, which could lead to increased income. These tactics could include additional marketing and sales and training. To date, the INGENAES project has conducted 7 technology assessments, which are available on the INGENAES website. In these profiles, they provide analysis around these 3 different areas of inquiry and also include conclusions and recommendations for the projects that are disseminating the technology. You can find that information here on the INGENAES website. We also have a couple additional resources, including a poster that goes through this process and a forthcoming guide. And our emails are available at the end of this webinar and the slides, and you can contact us if you'd like more information about that guide. So I've been looking at some of the questions that are popping up in the chat, and hopefully with some of these concluding remarks, we can address some of them, and then we look forward to answering some of the others more specifically. So we want to emphasize, as I had said at the beginning, our interest is not just about the technology. And in our assessments, often the impacts or the things that the ripple effect that we look at is not the result of the technology specifically, right? So we use the technology in some ways as a vehicle for being able to talk about other things that are happening as value chains get upgraded from many informal processes to formal processes. So an example of this is the digital fat tester, where yes, the digital fat tester itself is a technology that's introduced not at the farmer level, but at a collection center. And it provides information to the farmers about the quality of their milk. In one respect, you could say that it is a quote unquote gender neutral technology because it's introduced it's not introduced to either men or women farmers. However, what we'd like to see, or what we found through the assessment, was 2 things. One, introducing the digital fat tester
technology at the Milk Collection Center created a new opportunity for somebody to operate the fat tester. There was a new position available at the collection center. And so the question becomes, who is qualified to be able to take that opportunity, that new employment opportunity? And then we get to a question of how do men or women meet those qualifications? And while the technology itself isn't gender specific, it creates and has an impact, or like I said earlier, a ripple effect on what is available to men and women. The other thing about the technology assessment, in saying that it's not just about the technology, is that you have to look at other complementary interventions. So again, here, I'll use the digital fat tester as an example. The digital fat tester, in its very targeted purpose, was about providing information about the fat content of milk. At the same time that it was introduced, the project, which was a care project in Bangladesh, made a couple of other adjustments to the project by bringing milk collection centers closer to villages and to women, and installing or making available a fat tester at the collection center, which meant that what ended up happening was women were able to take part in marketing activities, and then they were able to receive information about how to improve the quality of the fodder so that they could increase the fat percentage of the milk that they were producing. So for us, as I had said earlier, it's not just about the technology and the immediate impacts of the technology. We want to look at some of the other ways an introduction of a new technology or upgrading of particular tasks can change. If you think about a pebble in water, has this ripple effect in other areas. So again, so coming to my second point, the assessment is a snapshot and it's trying to understand what happens around a particular technology. We're not attributing the introduction of a technology to particular outcomes. We're taking a snapshot and saying this is some of the things that happen around and this is some of the changes that are happening. Innovation inevitably always introduces change. And so our question is, what kind of change do we want to support? And if you're going to introduce a new technology that impacts people's lives in different ways, we ask the question, can you make that introduction of a new technology, can you use it to make other positive changes in people's lives? So can that technology be used as a means or a vehicle to think about ways to improve women's time, the way in which men and women spend their time or their energy or expend their energy? A key piece of the assessment process is to highlight some of the trade-offs that come out between multiple objectives. And I had noticed in the chat that there were a couple of comments around not increasing women's time burden and the way in which technology can reduce that. And we would agree that what you want to be able to do is look at the ways, is to look at some of these trade-offs between, say, an increase in time and an increase in income, or in the example that's on the slide, a new seed variety that reduces weeding, or fertilizer that reduces weeding, and what that means for landless men and women who provide wage labor on farms and weed, right? So there's trade-offs between either different groups of people as technologies get introduced, or there's trade-offs for an individual person. I have to decide whether I'm going to spend more time investing in caring for my cow, but the opportunity may be that I have an increase in income. So what we're trying to do is bring some of those things to the fore. That is the basis of the assessment. Again, we're looking at a very specific target audience for this type of information. The INGENAES project is about looking at the role of extension and providing extension officers with a way of thinking through, or people who work with extension officers with a way of thinking through some of these trade-offs. It may not be a new methodology or new thinking for many of you on the webinar, our target audience is very focused on looking at extension and the links between extension and advisory services. So we're now open to the Q&A, and our emails are up there, and I think Katie's going to help us moderate this next section.
Yes, hi, this is Katie. Thanks, Christina and Kate, for the presentation. We have a few questions. I'm going to just start with the first question. This is from Mona from Amsterdam. She said, isn't fat testing a gender-neutral technology? Or rather, how is slash was it gender biased?
Great. So on that one, that I sort of had answered that one previously. So I think the challenge with calling technologies gender neutral is that you could argue that many technologies, the technology itself is gender neutral, right? It is an object. Where the gender dynamics come into play is when the technology gets introduced to populations, to people. And that's where you want to look at the dynamics around what happens in the introduction and the use of the technology and the way in which men and women, the way it impacts men and women or how it relates to men and women's lives, right? So I think we tend to avoid talking about gender-neutral technologies because the technology itself lives in a social context, and we want to understand, and it may not be immediately apparent, the way in which that technology, as it comes out into the world, has an impact on men's and women's lives. And that's the piece that we're trying to assess and analyze.
Thanks, Christina. The next question is from Anita from Amsterdam. She said, how do you measure the extent of women and men's access to control over income derived from production sales? Do you have any resources or literature with the methodology or measuring tool?
So I'll take that one again. No, so we don't actually measure income. The technology, so the assessment process is largely a qualitative process. Let me say that differently. The assessment process uses both quantitative and qualitative data. The quantitative data should come from projects, right? So we're Feed the Future. INGENAES is a Feed the Future initiative funded project, and we work with a lot of Feed the Future projects. So we would look at their quantitative data that comes out from the Feed the Future monitoring system and look at some of the income data that they have, right? So we are not collecting data on income itself. So the guide does not provide guidance on that. What the guide has are a list of questionnaires for the qualitative portion of the assessment, which examines the purpose of the technology and which is used to talk to men and women about their perceptions about technology, how they experience the technology, and whether they feel that the technology has increased their well-being in some way. That is very differently recognized from actual increases in income. But if you think about the ways in which we use our own technologies, we have very different feelings about our cell phone or our cars or any number of different technologies in our life. And our perception of the usefulness of those technologies may in fact be different from whether or not they're actually adding having positive benefits on our life.
Okay, thanks, Christina. The next question is from Jeannie Harvey. She's in the U.S. She asked, is there a role for or recommendation to conduct a market analysis when designing technology assessments?
So the market analysis, we would argue that so the technology assessment is one piece, right? So it's not going to give you all the answers. It looks at a very narrow set of issues around the technology, and it certainly should not be used to substitute for things like a market analysis or a value chain analysis. It's complementary. There may be some overlap as well. But as I was just saying earlier, we're looking at the perceptions and qualitative work around what a technology can do or how people experience it. So it's not, we would not substitute for other, it's not a substitution for other analyses.
Okay, so this one is from Annette Malima. How was the data for this assessment collected? You may have already covered this, actually.
Could you repeat
that
question?
Was that how or who?
How was the data collected?
Sure. So the data was collected, the qualitative assessment was, the data was collected through interviews with people who are both using the technology and those who are not. So when we piloted the technology, people were trained, they went to Zambia and Bangladesh to different sites where projects were operating, and they used the guide, which has a series of questions which relate to our areas of inquiry. And then that data was collected and analyzed to as the basis for the gender analysis. Data was also collected, as Cristina mentioned before, through different types of literature on the numbers of people who are adopting the technology in the area, background information about the technology, and then also people who were involved in designing the technology, if available, were interviewed, as well as extension agents or project officers that were familiar with the groups that were receiving the technology and using it. That was carried out over anywhere between 2 weeks to a month of interviews. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. This one's from Olamide from Indiana. How was the impact of the technologies on nutrition measured?
Yeah, that's a great question. We admit that the nutritional portions of the assessment are weaker. And it's something that we are looking to improve in further work and future work with around the assessment. At the moment, and it's a very poor way of approaching some of the nutritional issues, and it's something that Kate mentioned, we're looking at it in terms, it's that first area of inquiry, the availability of food, the quality of the food, and the safety. And that gets closer to some of the nutritional issues that we want to understand in terms of dietary diversity. But we have not dealt well at the moment with understanding how increases we haven't dealt well in the assessment process with understanding how some of those improvements in quality, safety, and food availability have nutritional impacts on men and women in households and in communities. So we get close. What the assessment says is that there's movement in these areas, but we don't assume at this point that in making those statements that there are changes in people's nutritional status.
Yeah, I would also add that in the area of inquiry around income and assets, one of the questions that's asked of the farmers is if they're using any additional income to purchase, a more diverse diet food. So that's another way that we're getting at it, but we have a lot more to do on that.
Right, and as Diane's mentioning in the chat box, we had talked about looking at energy expenditure and some of the time savings that one would get. But in this round and in this very early version of the assessment process, we've had to make some decisions about what we can and can't deal with as we're trying to figure out some useful tools for extension and advisory services.
Okay, so the next question is from Frida in Missouri. She says, I would like to know how this tool is different from WIA and how it might be used in conjunction with WIA or A-WIA.
The tool is very different from WIA. WIA is an index, and I will probably not speak very well to explaining this, but it's a diagnostic tool that's done
It's a population-based survey. It's done at a very aggregate level, and it produces a snapshot of the ways in which women are disempowered or empowered in the agriculture sector. So it's at a very, very different level than what it is that we're doing here with the technology assessment, which is understanding technology and the impacts of the technology on men and women's lives. Now, when you decompose the WEA and you look at the different indicators and the sub-indicators within the WEA, you know, there are things that are related, the access to productive inputs, it's a stretch to say that these would even be complementary because of the different levels at which these processes or these two different methodologies are operationalized. I think that's the easiest answer to that question.
Okay, thanks, Cristina. This one's from Rolf from Washington, D.C. What kind of objective methods have you used to assess the impact of technologies on the outcomes you described?
Yeah, I saw that question come in. So it's a very modest effort at this point. And we've just coming out of the pilot activity. What the pilot activity did not do as well was to look at and compare the qualitative work around the perceptions around technology with some of the quantitative data that projects have available around particular changes. In future rounds of doing technology assessments, I think we would look to compare better some of the quantitative data coming out of the Feed the Future projects around income increases or production increases, and then look at that with the information coming from the interviews and use that as a somewhat of a validation process. It's insufficient, particularly if you're not using the same population, although we connect with the Feed the Future countries, so we're talking to similar people. But again, this is at this point a fairly modest effort to understand how we might be able to produce a tool that is useful for other people to then pick up, expand upon, and to hopefully improve.
Okay, thank you. This question is from Susan Novak from Oregon. Will you have resources to evaluate the sustainability of technology adoption and changes that have been introduced after project support is finished?
We don't actually look at adoption. We're looking at use and the sustainability question, I suppose you could use this to look at sustainability. I mean, if you were to, you could use it to look, I don't have a very good answer to that question, but it hasn't been one that we've treated so far. And I suppose there would be ways, I have to think about that, but I'm sure that there's ways that you could look at adoption itself. And sustainability, but I think there's probably better ways of looking or more thoughtful ways of looking at the adoption question because we weren't necessarily tackling adoption in and of itself.
Okay, we'll move to the next question then. This one is from Anita from Amsterdam. Do you also see how these extension services are impacting or has any effect on gender relations?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Yes. Anita asked if you also see how these extension services are impacting or how, if they have any effect on gender relationships.
No, that's not a part of this particular assessment.
Okay, so from Sophie from Washington, D.C., how or do you address men and women's access to collective resources and institutions at the village level, like the ability to access water from a collective irrigation scheme, land, farmer, producer groups, et cetera? Would you like me to repeat that or put it in the chat?
Yes.
So you can read it. It's kind of a couple different parts in there.
Yeah, I mean, to answer Sophie's question, before you go out and do the assessment, I mean, we have a simple guide that, you know, we have a questionnaire. We have a couple questionnaires that we use, you know, that are targeted for different audiences. One is for those people who are involved in the design of a technology. And then there's two different questionnaires, either for groups or individual men and women farmers who are either users or non-users of the technology. But before you even get to going out into the field, there's a considerable amount of background research that needs to be done to better understand what it is you actually have to ask when you go, or how you put together your strategy for conducting the assessment process. So it's very different, and we learned this as we worked through the pilot activity, which looked at seven different technologies. They were very different, from the treadle pumps to we looked at an aquaculture system, which was combined with homestead gardening. And then we looked at the DFT, which was not a technology that was introduced at the production level, right? So and I'm not answering directly the question from Sophie, but I think we spend a lot of time, we've started off with a very, targeted questionnaire, but through the course of putting this together, we realized that a single questionnaire is really insufficient for being able to deal with a lot of the complexity and the different contexts and different and the range of technologies that we look at. So you would have to think about how to modify or how to get at some of these issues around food availability or time and labor, or income and assets in the particular for the particular technology that you're working on and in the particular context. So you could definitely, you know, we'd like to think that it's that we've planted a seed of sorts, and people can take up some of these ideas and modify them to address some of these other issues that come about, like the collective resources and institutions. But our particular, what we have available right now may not necessarily meet all of those needs.
Okay, thanks for that answer, Cristina. We'll finish up the webinar with one more question. Sorry, we won't be able to get to all the questions today, but I thought this one was a good conclusion. So what messages do you give extension staff based on your analyses?
Yes.
What are the top three?
Okay, so... I saw that come in and I was wondering if you were going to choose that one.
Well, you could just do the top one.
Okay, so I think the first one is that for extension, for extension officers, it's important. I mean, in this we say, regardless of whether we're talking about technologies or something else, you have to understand, you have to know something about the people that you're working with. And most extension officers do. They know the people that they're working with, or many of them do. But the matching process, the usefulness of that information may not be always apparent. And we're trying so the first message is, what you know about the farmers that you work with, or what you think you know about the farmers that you work with, matters for the selection of the types of technologies or the crops you're targeting. So that would be a first message. A second message is that the technologies, if we go back to that arrow, that bottom arrow that goes from technology to gender roles, I think the other message to agricultural extension officers is that these technologies can improve men and women's lives in ways that are beyond mm-hmm. just whether you increase your maize or your sorghum or millet or rice. And that that talking about those benefits could potentially make the adoption or the use of those technologies more attractive. And that can be a useful strategy for promotion and dissemination. So that's two. And let me gather my thoughts and see if I can come up with a third one in a moment. But I got two out of three for the moment.
Well, I mean, it's also paying attention to the differences in what men's and women's preferences and needs are, and that there may be different and more appropriate ways to communicate with different groups. So understanding, particularly for disseminating technologies, what that might mean. So it's really listening to your client.